We have quite a wide audience. We have people from the region and beyond who are very keen on this webinar. So, Prof, I'd like to take this opportunity to start off. The others will join in as we progress. So, our viewers, we are really very glad to have you here with us. It's a great pleasure for us to be able to host you on today's webinar, where we're going to be looking at Rwanda's two decades of transformation, and we're going to be hosted. The facilitator for the session is Professor Arvinda Singh Chawla, with a career spanning over 40 years in teaching profession. He has had several leadership positions in the Punjab University, Patiala, and the University and the former Kigali Institute of Science and Technology, which is the University of Rwanda currently. He has had numerous positions where he has worked as a dean for research, registrar, dean College of Development Council, dean Faculty of Business Studies, and head of School of Management Studies, dean Resource Mobilization and Investment, director International Studies, and director Center for Management and Information Technology in Mohali. He was also a dean of the Faculty of Management Studies and also the head of department. He has also had a wide experience even in the private sector, where he has worked as a financial advisor in a Kenyan business conglomerate in 1995 to 1997. He has participated in Making Markets Work. It was a Harvard Business School program where he was coordinating executive education initiatives in East and Southern African region. You know, he has also coordinated various projects with USAID, Ministry of Health. He has also a well-traveled person. He has been an adjunct professor at the Wilkes University, USA, and the University of Southern Pacific in Fiji. He has also been involved with universities in more than two dozen countries, that is USA, Canada, Germany, Scotland, France, China, Singapore, Fiji, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, and Ethiopia, where he has been trying to forge academic collaborations. So this is just some of the few things that Professor has been able to do. So Prof, allow me to welcome you to today's webinar. Over to you, thank you.
Thank you, Min, thank you very much. It's been a long time. We have been trying to rope in for different activities, academic activities in Rwanda. You have introduced me as international speaker, but many a times I feel I'm not an international speaker when I'm talking to the audience in Rwanda, because I have been a part of Rwanda academic fraternity for a very long period of time. I have spent almost 4 years in the initial stages when Kigali Institute of Science and Technology was established, and later on it became University of Rwanda. I get a proud feeling when I recall my days staying in Rwanda and working in Kigali Institute of Science and Technology. I mean, and along with so many other, I should say now colleagues, because they worked with me in the dean in the Faculty of Management at KIST. And before that, I had the opportunity of having them as my students also. Amin was my proud student. And when I see all my students these days who are occupying very senior position in Rwanda in different organizations, that gives me a great feeling. There was a time period when we came to Rwanda, it was year 2000. And in the initial stages, the kind of picture we had in mind, I remember in those days we had conducted one study My vice rector at that time, engineer Albert Butare, Dr. Albert Butare now, we were involved in one study related to poverty alleviation and initiatives to come about poverty alleviation in the year 2000-2001. And the data at that time used was up to 1998, because that was the data available in the statistical department of government of Rwanda. Later on, there was a stage. I think some 5 years ago, I was invited in a seminar in Rwanda, and that was the time period when I had an opportunity of working on the difference that has occurred during this time period. Well, the time period when I entered for that seminar presentation in Rwanda, my impression was completely changed. What I found during the period 2004, 2000 to 2004, almost 4 years time period, in 2015, it was completely changed. I share with many of my friends in Rwanda that the house in Kiev where I used to live, in 2015, I wanted to have a look of that house. When I went with a driver in that particular area, the area was so developed that I was not in a position to locate so easily the house in which I used to live. It was so developed an area. And what to talk of Kiev, because that used to be comparatively developed area, even in year 2000, 2004 also, many other areas like Jikondo, Kakiru, you know, where we used to find a lot of isolation in those days, all these areas were too much developed and they were beyond my comprehension to have that kind of understanding that the country has developed so much. Well, those were the things which prompted me to work on and look into which are the areas where things have really changed. To be very frank, in 2000, when I came to Rwanda, we had a very different kind of impression given, as if we are going to a very isolated place. I had an experience of living in Kenya for 2 years, and I have been moving around some other places also in the region, where we used to have a lot of insecurity. And that kind of feeling was in our mind when we reached Kigali, and impression was changed in very few days when we found that the place was wonderful. And how things changed later on, they were rather fantastic. In this particular session, I'm going to pose a couple of questions, because let us be interactive, and in between somebody wants to raise some question, I'll be very happy to respond. But towards the later part, obviously we are going to have some discussion, because there may be some areas where we may have some kind of discussion to take place because of different viewpoint, a point of view which could be different from mine. Well, in the very first slide, I have not started with my presentation, but I have mentioned some 5 lines. I would come to these lines later on when the real context will come. Did you feel well rested? Did you feel respected all the day? Did you smile or laugh a lot? Did you learn something or to do something interesting? Did you feel enjoyment? Just remember, I'm not trying that you should focus on these things and put your mind here, but just keep it, these in mind while we will carry on with our discussion and see later on in the context of these 4 or 5 lines where we are moving, which direction Rwanda is taking, and what all has happened during last 2 decades in Rwanda. Well, first of all, I would like to see what positive things have been happening I would focus on certain major changes that have taken place during the last two decades. The data for 2000 was in front of me at that time also when we were in Rwanda ourselves. 1998, and by the time we were in the year 2002-2003, data for 2000 was available. And that became the reference point for me, because prior to that, a lot of changes were taking place because of what all turmoil the country had faced during 1994. And this period was a very challenging period. But we can say that some kind of real things started. Maybe I can mention even 1998, because when KIST was established, that was one of the biggest landmark, that was the biggest initiative to develop, you know, the skilled manpower and the education and the academic level engineers, managers to be prepared within the country. That was a big initiative. And that was the time on when I started watching some changes taking place in the country. If we see some figures on the basis of the parameter related to economic growth, Rwanda has been one of the fastest growing economy. If we see the figures, it was US dollar 5 billion economy in the year 2000, and it grew to 24.52 billion in 2017. Almost five times difference took place during this time period. We have seen almost 7.5% growth in GDP during last 20 years. If I take the figures from 2000 to 2019, the figure was when I prepared one presentation in 2015, at that time it was little below 7%, and we were aspiring this to be always more than 7%, and now averaging is 7.5%. There was time period 13.4% during the period 2074, which is considered to be a big achievement. For the year 2019, these are the estimates, you know, these the real figure is yet to come. The estimates are that it will be 10.1%, which vis-a-vis the targeted 7.5 is considered to be a very good figure. And of course, this year is not going to be very favorable because of COVID-19. We are expecting that it will go down, but this is an unusual year, 2000. That should not be considered to be a part of our journey, otherwise in the whole of the development process. Not only, you know, GDP, gross domestic per capita GDP, we also found per capita GDP also increased from US dollar 900 to 2000 and 2100 in the year 2000 on purchasing power parity basis. Another salient feature of the growth was that the contribution of the services sector went up drastically. It went up to 15.1% recently from 35% in the year 2000. And at the same time, agricultural sector's contribution decreased from 50% to around 31%, you know, the latest figures which we see for 2019 and 2020. This is one of the very significant change, because moment we move from primary sector to services sector, that is a big indicator of development. Contribution, agricultural or manufacturing sector remain always with very less value addition. The biggest value addition comes only through services sector, and services sector contribution has gone up in a big way during this time period. Well, those were the figures. Those are the data which normally anybody can refer to while explaining how the development of economy has been taking place. But what is counted at the international level, that is more important for us. And that is when we see Rwanda's economic freedom score, 70.9, making its economy 33rd freest in the year 2020 index. Rwanda ranked second amongst 47 countries in sub-Saharan Africa region, and its overall score is well above regional, not only regional, the world average also. That is something to be focused on. And when we are saying second amongst 47, let me tell you, the first one I don't really consider the part of Africa, you know, because of the region and all. We do consider Mauritius, but that is an island nation. Their parameters are completely different. If I just consider that fact in my mind, then Rwanda is the first. Mauritius is not in any case. The kind of topography or the processes through which all these Rwanda and neighboring countries are developing, I can say, let us forget about Mauritius. Rwanda is first amongst 46 countries in sub-Saharan Africa region, and its overall score, region, once again, I am focusing on, I don't say, it is above the world averages. During past 5 years, economic freedom advanced drastically. 65th rank with 64.8 score in 2015, it has come down to 33. Just imagine jumping 32 stages, 32 ranks during 5 years time period. And before that also, now, this was the time period when the score had advanced by 6.1. But even before that also, in a 5 years time period, the score had advanced by 2.1, which is a massive big achievement for the country. Well, not only economic freedom, when we see the investment freedom up from 40 to 60, between the year 2010 to 2020, against the global average, again, I am talking about global average of 57, Rwanda is at 60. Means massive, massive development during this time period. Lot of achievement during this time period. And 20 years time period, 15 years time period, in the growth process of any country is not a big time period. I know many times when we in India talk about 70 years of freedom and reaching to this particular level, at that time normally examples come, how many years US took place to come to this particular stage? Maybe 200 years. Just see the movies, 125 to 150 years old documentaries of US, you will find so much of backwardness in US. And then there was change during 50s, 40s time period that changed everything. And from that angle, 20 years time period is too small a time period for the achievement which we are observing. And I'll come to, the freedom from corruption later on also. There are some comparison between the countries in the region, but the present value of freedom from corruption stands at 58 from 10 in 2005, an average 30 for 25 years. This is considered to be a quite big achievement. You know, I will, when I'll come to the comparisons later on, you will come to know how much ahead Rwanda has gone in achieving comparatively clean administration over a 20 years time period. This is the second year in continuity when Rwandan economy has been rated mostly free. I mean, no bureaucratic hurdles. Before this, for continuous 8 years, it was considered to be moderately free, but for last continuous 2 years, it is considered to be mostly moved from moderately free to mostly free. Again, it is a big achievement in whole of the development process. I was going through some information, very interesting information, to be very frank. There are in the world these days, we talk about a lot of new things, innovations, creativity. And there was one ranking done, which was in four different categories. One was innovation in the economies which are high income, high innovation. The first one was Switzerland, recent. Second one, Sweden. And third one, USA. Then there were economies, upper middle income, high in innovation, which were in the range of upper middle income, but they were high in innovation, China, Malaysia, and Bulgaria. Low middle income, high in innovation, Vietnam, Ukraine, and Georgia. And when it came to low income, high in innovation, Rwanda was on the top. Just imagine the process of education, process of bringing young people out with education in the area of technical management and different other professional fields. So much of our innovation is taking place that in the world, in low income economies, which are considered high in innovation, Rwanda is on the top. It's a very, very significant achievement. In the World Banking ranking 2020, Rwanda has dropped in the World Bank Ease of Doing Business 2020 ranking to a position. There is a little difference. It came to 29, scoring 76-77. Mauritius is at 13. The most important thing to be noticed in this is Mauritius at 13 and Rwanda are the only two African countries which ranked in top 50 in World Bank Ease of Doing Business in the year 2020. Let us talk about certain other parameters which normally are considered to be very important. Well, inflation has been one of the area of concern. There has been a lot of effort being made over a period of time to keep it in control. There was a time period when it was well within the range normally expected to be in the economy, which normally we say 5%. There were many years when we had that particular level. But it has been erratic. Over a period of 20 years, the averaging has been 6.2%, as against 9 to 10% during the period prior to 1997. Up to 2017, it was going on perfectly okay in the positive direction, but for last 2-3 years, again, there has been some raise in the inflation, but corrective action is being taken. And I'm sure these in the smaller time period, the monetary policies and changes which normally takes place, it will take little time for it to smoothen out. But remember, there was a time period, it was as high as 28% also in the year 1997. We will discuss little more at the later stage when some solutions we will be talking about. Poverty normally in African region and many other developing nations is an issue. But if we focus on the parameters and the growth process during the period 2000, 2002 to 2016-17, up to which the data was available that I have taken for consideration, there has been massive decrease in poverty level. In the year 2000-2001-2, it was 58.9%, came down to 56.7% in 2006-2007. It was 44.9% in the year 2010-11 and reduced to 38.2% in 2016-17. In some quarters, I was reading some statements, some news in the newspapers where it has, in the year 2019 itself, it has been claimed that currently it is at 34%. But let us not focus on 34%. Let us focus on the figure which is given by, the government sources. During the same time period, if we see 2005-2006 to 2016-17, rural poverty came down from 61.9% to 43%, which again is a significant achievement. Urban poverty reduced from 28.5% to 15.8% during the same period, which again is a massive achievement. Extreme poverty, you know, where we consider less than $1.9, less than $2. Extreme poverty decreased from 40% to 16% during 16-17 years time period. It was 35.8% in the year 2006, in between the time period when we are talking about. And extreme poverty in urban areas stood at 5.9% and in rural area at 18.1% in the year 2016-2017, for which figures are available. And these are almost for two decades, you know, figures when we are taking poverty figures in the year 2000, they related to 1997-98. And this period of 20 years, there has been massive decline in poverty level. Well, there has been reduction in poverty, but the issue related to inequalities have not improved in that particular significant level. There has been improvement, no doubt about it. If you see the trend between 2005-06 to 2016-17, there has been reduction. There is a trend towards the reduction in inequalities. During this time period, ratio of 90th percentile of consumption to the 10th came down from 7.1 to 6.3. Well, most important is the last one when I talk about the Gini coefficient that fell from 0.5 to 0.49 up to 2015, and then recently in 2018 to 0.443. 443 means when we are moving towards one, that means the inequalities are reducing. One means no inequality, everything, everybody equal. 100 means extreme inequalities, but we are moving from the stage of 0.52 where we were in between, but we have moved towards 0.44, moving towards one, which talks about reduction in inequalities. It may not be that significant, but still we find a lot of improvement in that figure. Well, I come down to the same first one, which I had shown. There was one study. It was published in the New Times. It was a survey conducted. It was published in 25th March 2015 in New Times, in which these five questions were asked. Very interesting. I mean, if you go through That's why I showed you at number one that how is life in Rwanda. They were ranked on the basis of these five parameters, that while you are living in Rwanda, do you feel well rested? While in Rwanda, did you feel respected all the day? While in Rwanda, did you smile or laugh a lot? While in Rwanda, did you learn something or do something interesting? Did you feel enjoyment? There was a survey done on the basis of these parameters. And let's see what was the outcome of that particular survey. This particular survey, this study ranked Rwanda amongst best places to live, emerging top Africa and 15th globally. Number one in the African region and 15th globally. According to this particular study, which was done in 2015, this study said that Rwanda is the top first country in African region to live with tranquility, live with peace, live with comfort, live with enjoyment. And let us not talk about only African region. The rank was 15th in the world, which is not, I mean, you talk about 200 countries and 15th rank amongst all those countries. You're talking about life in Rwanda. It's so interesting. Rwanda tied up with US and Bhutan, all recording an indie, you know, I mean, the score of 79, which was, you know, for these two countries, and it was 8 higher than the global mean, the global average of 71. If we see the other countries in the region, Kenya was 33 with 77 index, Tanzania was 57th with 72 index, Uganda was 90th, Burundi was 100th. But just imagine, globally, Rwanda was 15th, and number one in the region means number one amongst the 47 countries. Normally, of course, you know, if again, we talk about Mauritius in the 36th place, which was not as good as Rwanda, as far as that part is also concerned, because Rwanda's score was, index score was higher than even Mauritius. But it is something interesting, you know, when we talk about life in Rwanda. I once again would like to mention, it was only Kigali where we used to walk on road even at 10 o'clock at night, 9 o'clock at night. No feeling of any insecurity. I remember I used to walk down from KISS to my house sometime after the class at 9:30. Our classes used to wind up at 9. We had never any kind of insecure feeling. But I also remember when I was living in Kenya, after 5 o'clock, we were not in a position to walk on the road in Kisumu or Kigali, in Nairobi at all. And that's something when we talk about life in Rwanda, which has been, this is the study in 2015. I have seen the days in 2004. And all the changes that took place on the positive side during this time period, that's an interesting achievement. I had mentioned to you that I'll later on again talked about the corruption. Rwanda is placed favorably on Corruption Perception Index of Transparency International, 51 in comparison to 179 in Congo, 185 in Burundi, 159 in Tanzania, 147 in Kenya, 159 in Uganda. Just imagine 51. So favorable, so comfortable position. It has jumped almost 70 places, left behind almost 70 countries during 20 years time period. It's a massive, massive achievement. You know, sometimes when I look at the countries where I live, you know, India and Pakistan and this place, they are so low in the scoring in these areas. And getting such high ranking, it's a massive achievement. This one I have already mentioned earlier, that it has been, for the second, it has been mentioned mostly free. Let us talk about trade and investment during this time period. There has been massive increase in the balance of trade performance since 1998, two decades, because if I have to take the figures, in the year 1998, it moved from 169.4, minus 169.4 million to in 1998 to minus 1.148 million billion in 2013, and minus 1.39 billion in 2013, and minus 1.01 in 2018. The gap has reduced a little bit between 2013 to 2018, but that's not the point, because sometimes it is an indicator. Bigger gap is an indicator of big quantum of trade also. More important is that we have moved from 64 million of exports to almost 970 million, maybe 1 billion by this time. You can see the jump of almost 15 to 16 times during this time period. And similar was the jump in the import. And the interesting thing, which I have not been able to quote here, is that there are massive imports which are re-exported. I mean, you are importing, and almost around 100 to 150 million, those are some rework, some work is done, and then they are re-exported. That's one of the achievement as it goes. That means that services sector is getting a lot of dominance even in the import and export business activity also. Going ahead, you know, in the trade and investment activity, you know, when I was in Rwanda during 2000-2004 time period, all my colleagues, Amin was my colleague, Lillian, Octave, and so many others, initially, they were my student when I came in 2000, but in 2002, they all became my colleagues. We used to talk a lot, and particularly this first thing which I'm going to mention, I used to ask them, what is the saving rate? Because, you know, in some of the developing countries, saving rate helps a lot in the development process, in capital formation. And it was so low. We used to be astonished. It was negative in the late 90s because borrowings were more from the other countries and indigenous savings and capital formation was much lesser, but it has increased. I was very happy to see this figure that in the year 2010, Rwanda started 4.2% saving at 4.2%. to 7.8 in 2011, to 7.5 in 2012, 10% in 2013, 12% in 2017, and the target for 2024 is that saving rate will be 24%. It looks to be, you know, quite, the target looks to be quite on high side, But even if a significant improvement is there from 12% right now, this is going to help in a big way for capital formation in the country. Well, one of the study which was done in 2016, FinScope survey, mentions that 86% of the adults in Rwanda, they have started saving. This is a big number. This is a number which ultimately helps in capital formation in the country, because saving means money coming in the formal sector. Money coming in the formal sector going to the businesses, a cycle which is maintained. And this cycle helps the strong foundations for the economy to be laid. And you see the investment which have been coming to the country, in 2019, Rwanda recorded a record total investment of 2.46 billion, which is a massive, massive improvement, massive increase over a period of time. Foreign direct investment inflows in Rwanda increased from 8.64% during 17 to 18. From the previous year to the next year, there was increase of 8%. And one of the top 10 favored nations by the investors in the continent. Out of 47 countries, Rwanda was one of the most favored. The World Economic Forum Global Competitiveness Report 2013-14, this again I have already mentioned, you know, next to Mauritius, they consider to be, Rwanda is considered to be the best place to come and to invest and to, favored nation. Let us talk about how much development process took place in the area of infrastructure. 0.5% population only having connections, telecom connection 22 years ago, you know, when we were there in 1999, 2000, eager 5,000 connections, which had a penetration to 25.4% population, from half percent population to 24.5% population in 2014, and 78.8% population in 2019. This much was the penetration of telecom sector, one of the fastest growing amongst the countries in the world. Road conditions. Last time, Amin invited me for one of the annual conferences, which was to be held in Giseni. They call it some different place now, but I know that place as a Giseni, because in my days it was Giseni and we used to go for, weekend holiday to either Kiyovu, Giseni and the other place, towards this UNR we had, Kiyovu. On the bank of Lake Kivu. I asked him, we used to take a lot of time to go to Giseni from Kigali. It was 165 kilometers, but it used to take some 4 hours. Amin said, you don't know the road conditions. They are massive, smooth roads. It will not take more than 2 hours to reach Giseni now. Well, it was a little unbelievable. But when I see these figures, the improvement which has taken place, unpaved to paved, I can see within the cities. I, the house where I used to live in Kiyovu,
In front of that, I had an unpaved dusty road. But it was beyond my recognition when I went to see that house. Everything, you know, going to Jikondo, where we have School of Finance and Banking, the kind of road network which I saw showed that there has been a lot of development taking place in the road conditions. Water supply, sanitation conditions also improved tremendously. The figures are not, new, but during this time period, whatever has been mentioned, it mentioned that it improved, sanitation improved from 38% in 2006 to 74.5%, which is almost double the figure of penetration in terms of availability of these facilities. Well, these were some of the very, very positive developments which have been taking place during 20 years time period. But let us talk about few areas where still some focus has to be laid, some effort to be made for improvement. The first one in this process is low ranking in Human Development Index. Per head GDP is still low due to higher increase in population. I'll go for some details later on. I'm just reading. I had already mentioned that inflation, you know, inconsistency in the inflation, sometime high, sometime low, that becomes sometime discouraging thing for people and the business community. There has to be consistency, whatever may be the level. That is also area of concern. Disparities, I did mention. Accessibility to health services, I did mention. Accessibility to higher educational at affordable. We will go through, you know, some of these points in detail when I refer to. Let's talk about one by one. GDP has been, percentage growth in GDP has been massive. I think what happened in Botswana during 80s after 1985, that was one of the fastest growing at that point of time. And we considered that to be a decade of, the decade of 80s as the decade of Botswana, like we used to call decade of 60s for the Japan, 70s for Singapore. 80s was the decade for Botswana. 90s was the decade for Costa Rica. The growth which we observe in terms of percentage, I have already mentioned, has been massive in Rwanda. 7.5% growth over a long period of 20 years, and then reaching even up to the level of 13% during some time period. And even now, if this COVID would not have happened, it would have been more than 10%. It's not a small figure. It's a massive figure. But then at the same time, we have to see how much, you know, we are improving in per capita. We have gone up from 7,800 to 2,100 during this time period, but there need to be, you know, raise in that part also, because real impact will be visible vis-a-vis other developing countries and Rwanda if per capita, GDP also goes up still more substantially, although there is a rise, but it's still. And when, you know, the other one is population is also increasing, you know, density of population is very high. And sometimes some of the development processes which are brought in by the country, they are offset by, economic gains are offset by the population increase. That is one area again to be taken into consideration. This I have already mentioned about the erratic movement of inflation rate. There is a need to bring it below 5%, and efforts are on that I have already mentioned. Disparities I had mentioned. poverty has reduced, but disparities continues to be there. Bottom 20% people consume only 5% of resources, and top 20% people consume around 50%. This has to be brought down. We are moving as per Gini coefficient, that is reducing, but there has to be an effort to improve it further. And when you say 20% having resources only 5%, then there may be a population which may be not having enough resources for eating and feeding themselves. Why we say disparities are concerned? Poverty may not be concerned sometime, but disparities may be, because in the same social system, jealousies and social problems, those are the kind of things which when start going into the minds of people, then social problem arise. That's why I say that while we are trying to bring down poverty level, it has come down to 34%. As I said, I read it in one of the speeches in newspaper, which is a massive improvement. We must try to bridge the gap between rich and poor also. The changes which have taken place over a period of time, these are very encouraging figures when we talk about the disparities which have been going down. And these are the figures in terms of the Human Development Index, which I wanted to mention. This, that slide has come before. Rwanda is cited as a country where the Human Development Index score is still, it has improved, you know, from 160, 8 to 157 during period of 2013. At one stage, it has rose to 151 also. Although other countries, they are also not favorable within the region, like Tanzania 159, Uganda 59, Burundi 185, Congo 179, but it still is considered to be on the lower side. Reason? There are certain parameters where there is a need for still more focus. You know, those are the, if I mention is about the inequalities which I have talked about, the life expectancy, of course, you know, this is one part of Human Development Index which has improved substantially. When I was there, I remember life expectancy used to be around 47 years, which has gone up to 68.7. That, of course, is an indicator quite improved. But overall ranking, you know, in all these areas where we talk about the sanitation, education, life expectancy at the time of birth, these parameters, they still are required to be improved further, which will bring, you know, the HDI towards a better ranking. But one important thing to be mentioned, which is taken positively in this also, and that is that the rank of per capita income, if you see the rank, world ranking, and if you see the world ranking in terms of Human Development Index, there is a gap of 20 ranks, which means that with the similar per capita income, many other countries are not in a position to achieve that rank which Rwanda has achieved. That again is an achievement, but still, I think this is an area where, you know, health conditions, health penetration, health services penetration, education, because even now a lot of people go out for study. Of course, a lot of efforts were made. I remember University of Rwanda, which came up in 2006, but KIST was one of the great initiative taken at that time for skilling of people in the country. Water supply needs augmentation. power situation is also, you know, if I go through I'm trying to be a little fast now because I see time is becoming a constraint, because I want to take some questions. We want to have some discussion. I would like to be a little quick. Currently 221 megawatt installed generating capacity, and most of it is the other, you know, out of total is the oil fuel based, which is expensive. 72% in urban areas and 12% in rural areas, the penetration that requires, you know, a lot of improvement. And this is also one of the area, if improved, human development index will go up. Accessibility to school education, quite favorable. But then later on, you know, there is a dropout, and at secondary level, that needs to be improved so that at higher education, higher level, there is a access to larger student population, larger school going children can also, in majority of you know, big countries like UK, 50% of UK is the access to higher education, 47% is in G8 countries. In Rwanda, it is still very low. What can be done? There's a need for, as I said, from primary sector to the services sector, if we have to further improve on moving fast development, although it is, because agriculture doesn't add that much value, as much skilling adds, as much services add. Infrastructure has to be developed, particularly power and roads, to match the development pace. Otherwise, you will have a lot of development, but if these are not matched, IT intervention is already, you know, there. I can imagine the way we are interacting through digital media today, and Rwanda is not behind. Rwanda is quite, in, you know, advanced in all these. Focus should be on removal of disparities. Let us not talk about too much on reduction of poverty. Let us talk about reduction of disparities. That is another area to be focused on. Before I go to the question answer, maybe a few questions Amin must have already gathered, few queries and points for discussion. I just want to mention very eloquently. I just now mentioned that 80s was the decade of Botswana, 70s was the decade of Singapore, 60s was the decade of Japan, 90s was the decade of Costa Rica. If I see the development process, and if the pace is picked up in the same manner, I have no hesitation to say that the decade 21 to 30 can be decade of Rwanda. If the pace is picked up in the same manner, in the consistency that has been seen during last couple of years, it will be much more advanced in many areas that globally Rwanda could be given the decade of 21-30, and that will be one of the very, very significant achievement for this small country. No one ever anticipated that this can be, you know, when we were starting with this presentation, I asked Amin, which building is this behind you, which is getting projected here? He said, this is a convention center. Such a beautiful building. I mean, it looked like as you are sitting in one of the most developed nations. And that was the feeling I also got in 2005. I remember we used to walk behind this Milcolin Hotel and go towards the bigger round. After a few, say 100 meters or so, a lot of such area would come towards the jail side and all, where you will see that it is not so well developed. But now, I mean, that Boga Market where we used to go, tall building, constructed, you know, the floors and all for all those people to do their business. All those kind of changes, which normally you observe in some of the advanced countries. If that kind of development pace continues, I'm sure this decade is going to be a decade of Rwanda. I would stop here because time is rather too much. And I would be very happy to take some questions, discussion, because there may be some people who would like to contradict me on a couple of points. But let me tell you, in whole of the process, there could be a little bias also, because I have too much of a faction for the country, because I lived 4 years is a big time period. And the community and the fraternity with which I lived for 4 years, all my students, all my colleagues, I was so thick with them. They were all so lovable that I'm not in a position to forget all those days. And there may be some bias when I'm talking about all these positive things. There may be some contradiction. If there are, I'm ready to take up that and discuss on that. Thank you very much. Yes, Amin.
Yes, Prof. Yeah, thank you for that elaborate presentation. I hope you have where to jot down a few of these questions so that we can go through them very quickly. As time is not on our side. The first question, just for the members to understand, we had 144 people who registered for this webinar, and 82 of them managed to turn up for this session, which is wonderful. And they are from around 10 countries: Uganda, US, Rwanda, Kenya, Zimbabwe, Lesotho, Australia, Nigeria, India, and the UK. And the majority, of course, are Rwandans and Kenyans. And thank you so much, our Kenyan brothers, for really being very supportive. We appreciate your support, and all the other participants. So, Prof, going to the question, we have somebody called Henry Misiani. Kindly let the presenter brief us how President Kagame is dealing with corruption and, if possible, actions he took to kill it. That is Henry Misiani from Kenya. Then we have Jet Maina from Kenya, I guess. Data trends quite insightful. What are the favorable conditions that influence the growth and development of Rwanda, and the lessons for my country, Kenya? Those are the ones we have on Zoom, but I'll go quickly on Facebook. We also have another question there. The GDP level data in African countries always fails to depict or illustrate actual or real development impacts associated with it. Why this obsession with the middle income status? Because every country seems to be pushing for middle income, whether low or high, seems to be like kind of the dream. So if you can touch on those, then we can bring this webinar to a close.
You know, the first thing which I would like to mention, in any country, process of development, stability of the government, stability of the party, the people who are at the helm of affairs, is one of the important features. And interestingly, in Rwanda, there has been a lot of consistency as far as the government is concerned. Let me tell you how I am impressed with the process. And of course, dealing at the level of different departments in the government, I'm not there, I'm not the part of the system where I can comment upon the inside, but what we see from outside. It was the year, I think, towards late, around 2008-2007, the educationist who used to be our vice chancellor, I mean, rector of KIST, became the education minister of the country. He had a lot of background of education, being the, you know, vice chancellor of University of, Rwanda, University of Butare, and then the KIST for a long period of time, and after that, education minister. And after that, in 2015, I saw Dr. Musafiri becoming the education minister. He was my colleague. When we see people picked up from the core professional areas to man the ministries and look after that, certainly the results are going to be positive. In majority of, when I see India and adjoining countries in this part of the region, these are not the parameters on which we find the people at the ministerial level in the cabinets who are manning the position. Sometimes you have a finance man who doesn't know anything about the finance. Sometimes you have an education minister knowing nothing about the education. But these are few things which have been significant in Dr. Paul Kagame's administration. As a president, he has always selected people who were high in their professional achievements, and when they were manning those ministries, the results were on the expected lines. They have shown significant changes, and this consistency in administration that has brought in improvement in the Rwandan economy. Vis-a-vis other countries in the region, I cannot, because maybe we were talking about, a week ago, that we can have a series of discussions and other subjects. In the sequence, I can come back again someday when I can pick up the adjoining countries also. But if we see the rankings vis-a-vis those, the significant improvement which has taken place, that has been the indicator of that. I do agree sometime that percentage of GDP doesn't get reflected. It may be for a shorter period of time, maybe because base sometime is so small that the percentage comes out to be bigger when you make improvement. But it is, if not that significantly, is matching with per capita income that has also gone up from, although it may be again amongst the low rank countries, but it has also improved in a significant manner. The percentage there is also not low. That is almost correlated perfectly when you see going up from 7,800 to 2,100 or 2,070 something, which is coming for this year. There is also improvement, although we know vis-a-vis majority of the countries in the world that 2,100 figure is not that large. But many things, if you compare the resources required for living, I remember the time period when I was living there, vis-a-vis the same resources which are required. See, example, between the countries itself, the states, resources you require to live in Michigan in US and the resources you require to live in California, you need four times the resources to live in California. That is the difference. So when you see per capita, money coming in the hands of people, which used to be so meager at one stage, there is an improvement. And from that, we can say that if GDP continues to rise, that will also help per capita dollars coming in the hands of people on purchasing power parity basis. it will make a lot of changes in the lives of people. And we have seen the lives of people over a period of time have changed. People have improved over a period of time in terms of different access to different facilities. Which was the other question?
Maybe I'll add on a few. There's one which says that what is it that Rwanda is doing that other countries have failed to do? And what, if what Rwanda is doing is good, can this be copied or framed into a model that can be applied to other countries? That is one question.
Yes, I think one by one we can respond. Okay. Let me tell you, jumping 70 ranks in corruption perception, I have not seen many countries. I mean, India, 4 or 5 ranks, 10 ranks over a period of 20 years ever since this perception transparency index came. Rwanda has jumped 70. Rwanda, in terms of doing business comfort level, that has gone so up. These are few things which are unmatched with the countries adjoining Rwanda that make it distinct, that makes it different. You know, these are few things which you cannot hide. You know, these are not the information or data collected by Rwandan government to present. These are the international agencies which are doing. If it is doing business in Rwanda, if it is tranquility, of living in Rwanda, if it is, corruption status position in Rwanda, if it is ranking amongst the region and the global, these are not the ranks which are assigned to Rwanda by Rwandan government, which you can say that, okay, it may not be, there may be some difference in opinion or whatever. These are the ranks which are given by international agencies, and that distinguishes, and I'm sure I have lived in Uganda also, I have lived in Kenya also. Few of these things, I just don't want to mention, you know, we are sitting on a digital media where some of the words, some of the experiences which I had in administration in Kenya, if I talk about that, I mean, they were amazing in terms of corruption or whatever. They need not be described, you know, on this platform. But I saw Rwanda very clean in majority of these parameters. And that, in fact, is something pushing Rwanda much ahead of all the countries which are in the region adjoining Rwanda.
So, Prof, if you allow, we can move on to the next question.
Yeah, sure.
What are the key factors that have contributed to Rwanda's success story? That is Ruth Waweru.
I think, all the key factors, all the figures which I have I've been talking about, majority, education, the way higher education, they started picking up. It was one of the very, very significant step taken in the late 90s by the government, when this was provided a lot of focus, a lot of freeness in terms of affordability, lot of privileges given to young people to get educated, lot of scholarships given to, you know, the young population to go out and educate themselves. One of the biggest factors contributing towards this. And then making everything easy. Again, I am coming to the same data. The ranking, transparency, corruption, doing business, inviting people, and see the development behind you. All these kind of processes which have taken place, they attracted, you know, some of the developed countries towards this nation. And I go to the first 5 things which I have raised, life in Rwanda, that continues to dominate my thinking, influence my thinking, and those are the contributing factor, continues to be contributing factors to distinguish Rwanda from the other countries. And I again would like, you know, the all, you know, the participants again to refer to those. Did you feel well rested? I mean, so comfortable. Did you feel respected all the day? Did you smile or laugh a lot? Did you learn something or do something interesting? Very high in innovation. Did you feel enjoyment? These are, I think, few things which summarizes that how Rwanda within that region is different from others.
Yeah, thank you, Prof. Just before I let you off the hook, there's one from Manish Gupta. Since you talked about the imports and re-exports, how much it impacts the growth, because it depends also on the relations with the neighboring countries.
There's something came in between. Can you again, once again, raise the point?
Yes, Manish Gupta is asking, since you talked about the imports and re-exports, how much it impacts the growth, because it depends also on the relations with the neighboring countries.
Well, when we talk about export and import, yes, it do make some difference, but essentially, if whole of the import and export is with the neighboring countries, when you see the list of exports, imports, more than 50% is not to the neighboring countries. It is, you know, particularly when you talk about, you know, the gold, hides, skins, diamonds, all those kind of things, they are not within the region. They are somewhere else. They are reworked also. Particularly when there is a foreign direct investment, particularly when there are foreign investors, they come with the intention that they have to do something, taking back not only in the neighboring countries. You know, between the neighboring countries, export and import is only for the low value addition items, you know, need of agricultural items, need of those areas which are the essential requirements within the country. But value addition always will be when you will be using. I remember even the time period I used to be there, I had a neighbor who used to export diamonds to Israel. They had a diamond business. And it was such a big value addition. So it depends. Because, you know, these days we are dependent on import and export simply because our dependence for different kind of requirements is on the other countries, and it amounts to the foreign currency and the requirements of different currencies, because we have to bring in so many things for the requirement of the country. And within the region, it may not be that important, because all those import and exports within the region maybe of low value items, but high value item is always added, and that should be focused. That should be the area where there should be concentration. Figures have been quite impressive, not that impressive, but it requires still a change, because there is a wide gap between import and exports. But when I mentioned the figure of re-exporting, something comes, worked on and re-export, that figure is becoming important, because that all is service value addition, important for the country.
Yeah, thank you, Prof, for today's webinar, for your time. You've been very generous. I see we've stretched in by a couple of 20 or so minutes.
No issues. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. I'm talking to my people. Is any one of my students also, my former colleague, participating today?
Yes, quite a number of people have participated, and they can continue, since the session is live, they can continue to look at the video. It's going to be on Facebook, it's going to be on YouTube, so why not? So thank you so much, and I also want to take the opportunity to thank our viewers from different countries for making out the time, and also to invite them for the next session, which we have. Prof, you've talked about the wellness of people. So as far as the wellness is concerned, I have our next speaker for next Tuesday. She's Dr. Esperanza Diodate Kilonzo. She's the founder and nutritionist of Belly Foundation. You know, it's in these times of COVID, it's good to keep your nutrition high, your nutrition and your well-being. It's very important if we are really going to survive during these difficult times. So I invite you to really tune in next Tuesday so that we can be able to also take care of look at our lifestyle and be able to live a much happier and healthy life. Thank you so much.
Surely, I'll be there. We will be there. Yeah, I'll participate in that.
Surely. All right, take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Amin. Thank you very much. Yeah.